اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا رسول الله. السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أمير المؤمنين. السلام عليك سيدتي ومولاتي يا زهراء يا زهراء. السلام عليك سيدتي يا فاطمة الزهراء. Salutations be upon you, O beloved Lady Zahra, for the martyrdom of our beloved Imam Hussein. Dear brothers and sisters, someone one time came to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. He said, "O beloved Prophet Muhammad, I'm a man with a lot of wealth and money. I wanted to go and perform pilgrimage. I wanted to go and fulfill my Hajj. I wanted to go and perform the Hajj in the house of Allah. But I couldn't make it, beloved Prophet Muhammad. What should I do?" He said and told him, "Oh, by Allah, I swear, if you had equal gold to this mountain of Abi Qubais, imagine if you fill equally amount equal to the mountain of Abi Qubais of gold, and you spend it in the way of Allah, you would have never reached what the pilgrim would meet and reach in the way of Allah. Look at the value of performing Hajj. Look at the value of visiting the house of Allah." They say someone asked Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Then Imam alayhi salam asked him this question: "How many times have you performed the Hajj?" He told him, 19 times, beloved Imam. He told him, "If you would complete the 19, make them 21 times. You perform the Hajj, then and only then you would have the blessings alike to the one who visited Imam Hussein in Karbala." Ya Sayyidi, dear brothers and sisters, every time someone came to Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, told him, beloved Imam, sometimes we're not allowed and we cannot get and reach to say salutations and visit our beloved Imam Hussein. What shall we do? What should we do? He told him, you have no excuse. He said, but how? He said, can't you go in your house to the highest point on your roof? Stand, direct yourself towards Imam Hussein and recite and say, As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdillah. Dear brothers and sisters, when you say the words, the salutations, when you recite the words, As-salamu alayk, and you direct your hearts to Imam Hussein, it is like someone visiting Imam Hussein in Karbala. When we say, As-salamu alayk, ya Hussein, As-salamu alayk, ya Aba Abdillah, As-salamu alayk, ya Bna Rasulillah. Say it from your heart, call upon him, direct yourself towards Karbala, as if you're talking to your beloved Imam Hussein. As-salamu ala al-Hussein, as-salamu ala Ali ibn al-Hussein, as-salamu ala أبناء الحسين، السلام على أولاد الحسين، السلام على أصحاب الحسين، السلام عليك يا ابن خاتم الأنبياء، السلام عليك يا ابن سيد الأوصياء، السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء، السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى، السلام عليك يا ابن سدرة المنتهى، السلام عليك يا ابن جنة المأوى، السلام عليك يا ابن زمزم والصفا، السلام على القتيل المظلوم، he was killed and oppressed، السلام على أخيه المسموم، salutations on his brother who was poisoned، السلام على علي الكبير، السلام على الرضيع الصغير، السلام على الشيب الخضيب، السلام على الخد التريب. سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله الحسين، يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما. صلوات. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه
ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. والصلاة والسلام على حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Dear respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The Almighty Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Holy Quran in Surah Al-Rum verse 54, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله الذي خلقكم من ضعف ثم جعل من بعد ضعف قوة ثم جعل من بعد قوة ضعفا وشيبة يخلق ما يشاء وهو العليم القدير. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum once again, and I thank you for being a participant in these majalis, in these gatherings, to bring the mention of Ahlul Bayt salamullahi ta'ala alayhim, to bring the word of Imam Hussein salamullahi ta'ala alayh, to remind yourself, remind others, participate as a group, as a community, as an individual, to raise the flag of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The word Ya Hussein, when you utter the word Ya Hussein, when you say the salutation Assalamu alayka Ya Aba Abdillah, when you say that, there is a relationship that you create between the self, you, and the individual that you're reciting the salam towards. When you say Assalamu alayka Ya Aba Abdillah alayhi salam, you are creating a relationship, a bond between you as an individual and Imam Hussein salamullahi ta'ala alayhi. The bond is dictated by the intent you have in the salam, in the salutation, as you stand humbled before the Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayhi. Because, dear brothers and sisters, when you recite the salam to Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, there is another Imam witnessing this salam as you give it to an Imam, a live Imam witnessing your salam to the Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam in Karbala, al-Imam al-Mahdi ajalallahu ta'ala faraja, as he witnesses your giving of the salam to the Imam. You are committing, you are promising, you are saying and telling the Imam of the time, my bond with you, alike to the bond of the Imam, knows no time, because I am today saluting and giving peace and comfort and blessings to my soul within this principle of Imama, where I find myself placed as a humble servant, as I recite, remember, and listen to the Imam of the time 1400 years ago. I also submit to your instructions and orders, O beloved Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. Dear brothers and sisters, today like any day in the 10 days of Muharram when we try to bring to mention the events of Karbala. We try to understand the purpose is not just the historical value, but again and again, and I will emphasize this, is what do I take home with me as an individual, as a son, as a brother, as a father, as a grandfather, as a sister, as a mother, as an individual, what do I carry with me as part of this group and this community? Because nowhere in Islam does it permit us or tell us that we should live in isolation from everyone. On the contrary, in Islam it promotes and it encourages and it tells us how we live together as a community, so we can grow, so we can prosper, so we become a stronger. And this is, if you look at Imam Hussein salamullahi ta'ala alayhi in Karbala, the beauty of it, that you see every aspect of a community was there in it in the battlefield before and after. Because you'll see the women and the children, the young and the old, the strong and the weak, the healthy and the sick, they were all with the Imam alayhi salam. He took them because this was a community in motion, a community that is moving towards a decisive purpose and a very well-drawn objective. Imam Hussein alayhi salam provided the wisdom, he provided direction, he provided the leadership, and everyone else went around the Imam alayhi salam and backed the Imam alayhi salam. They were there with the Imam alayhi salam because they were immersed in that wisdom. They loved that wisdom. They loved that leadership. They believed in that leadership. They were all calling Ya Hussein. Why? Because they believed in the principles of Ya Hussein. They lived, they were breathing the principles of Ya Hussein. They believed in what Hussein salamullahi ta'ala alayhi stood up for. And there today we are within this community, in motion, throughout time, we are carrying that banner, understanding these principles, and moving forward. The question is, are you moving forward or not? Are you as an individual, and are you as a community? I want you to apply and think and reference what I will talk about throughout these nights. Two words: today, the now, the I, and the we. Two words: today, the now, practicality, reality. How is it that I take these concepts and principles and live them? Live Imam Hussein alayhi salam in every breath that I take. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the verse that I recited earlier, Allahu alladhi khalaqakum min dha'fin thumma ja'ala. God, Allah, is the one who created you from weakness, then made after weakness strength. ثُمَّ جَعَلَ مِن بَعْدِ ضَعْفٍ قُوَّةٍ. ضَعْف is weakness, قُوَّة is strength. ثُمَّ جَعَلَ مِن بَعْدِ قُوَّةٍ. Then he made after that strength weakness and white hair. قُوَّةٍ ضَعْفًا وَشَيْبًا. يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ. He creates what he wills. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْقَدِيرُ. And he is the all-knowing, the all-competent. Now, when you read and recite a verse, dear brothers and sisters, look at the closing statement. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْقَدِيرُ. He's all-knowing, he's all-competent, he's able. Allah can do whatever He wills to do, but His will stems from the wisdom. So whatever is created in this vast universe has a purpose in it, and it's fulfilling its purpose within this creation. What distinguishes mankind, you and I, is the ability to decide, is the ability to decide amongst our choices. And that's why you will see within this universe, Allah Azza wa Jal made everything available to us. سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. He made everything, everything in the universe at your service. Why? Because the choices are ours, the decisions become ours, and we are held responsible. These decisions are the means which will get us to the fulfilled purpose Allah created us for. And within there lies our happiness and joy. So therefore, a human being cannot live independent of the knowledge that Allah provides him. There is the inner knowledge and there is the outer knowledge that we gain. There is the inner knowledge, al-fitra, and the innate which we grow within. Either we lock it and we do not let it prosper within us, or no, we let it grow and let it interact properly within everything here. Allah Azza wa Jal in this verse, He talks about the three stages mankind goes through. He goes through the age of youth when he is young, then when he becomes an adult, and then when he's an elder. It's three stages. The beauty is, we go through these stages, each and every one of us. How do we deal with these three stages, dear brothers and sisters? How do you and I go through these three stages? And what is it we do in order for us to maximize on the benefit of each stage? In addition, because when we look at the sayings of Ahlul Bayt salamullahi ta'ala alayhim, we will realize that they addressed each and every stage, what a person should do and what he or she should not do. Why did they put these limitations, restrictions, and regulations? Is it because they don't want us to enjoy the choices that we have? No. It is because each choice that we have, each option in life, has benefits and also can be harmful, depending on how we deal with it. Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam are teaching us how to handle things in the outside so you and I can benefit from. If we don't take these recommendations, let me tell you, we'll pay for it. So let us understand these concepts and why is it important. Remember yesterday I said every community requires three W's. Three W's. You miss one of these W's, you have a problem within the community. The first W is what? The wisdom, the knowledge. Without a knowledge, without direction, without the know-how, how, what are we going to do? Where are we going? This community is in loss. And then the community needs the work, the people in it to actually do the work. And the third W is the wealth, the resources. The three W's. We're not going to talk about the wealth. MashaAllah, our community has an abundance of wealth. We're not going to talk about that. And let me tell you, we cry, we talk, we need money and all that stuff. It's not because there is no money. There's a lack of trust where the money goes so the money holder can release the money. There is a problem with trust. A trust in what? In two things. The work and the wisdom. The first thing, a person with wealth says, well, who says you're doing the right thing? Who says you know what the right thing is? So I can support you. And secondly, where are the people that are doing the work? Where is your product showing? So here, dear brothers and sisters, it is important to realize we're building this circle. And everything is connected to one another. So we're going to talk about the work and the people. The people that are providing the work and we're providing the work to. See, there are three stages. Young, adults, and elderly. What happens? I hope that you will accept my honesty and frankness. I'm going to be very frank because there are things, this podium that I stand before you and address you from has me with a lot of responsibilities and duties. There are things that we ought to know in accordance to Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam's teachings. Because if we don't do it, and we don't listen, and we don't learn, all we're doing is trying, then we may hit it, we may do it right, and we may fail. I don't know. Because we face problems as individuals in the community, in the three stages of life. Whether the young, the adults, or the elderly. No one is going to be safe from me today, or the coming days. Because I start with myself. I started with my young age. I'll stop at the adults. I'm still growing, inshallah. But the thing is, we don't exist individually separated as generations. We are molding together. We are growing together. We depend on each other. I want to address the problems and then address the solution. Don't be such a community, because let me be frank with you. As an individual, through my volunteer work, I counsel many communities, many individuals, many couples, different ages. And let me tell you one thing I've seen in common with all the communities across the board, nationwide and globally. Most of our communities who are followers of Ahlul Bayt salamullahi ta'ala alayhim have very similar problems. Whether you're here in Chicago, in Detroit, whether you're in Florida, in Illinois, in California, whether you go to Iraq, you go to Kuwait, you go to Saudi Arabia, you go to Lebanon, you go to Iran, you go to Pakistan, you go to India, you go to Europe, you go to Africa, you come back here, don't forget Canada. We all have the same problems. Why? Because today the community is so connected that you and I are so connected with individuals overseas, and we can communicate with them with a blink of an eye. Sometimes even faster. It's how fast you can punch in the send button. Today, you can click as you're sitting in the majlis in DC and share the content with something, with someone who is in London, with someone who is in Najaf, with someone who is in Qom, in Pakistan, in India, with a click of a button. You know how dangerous this is? Once you say something, it's gone. God, back in the days, you say something, it's only 3-4 people. No one is taking pictures, no one is taking video, no one is recording your sound bites, none of that. You just hope they grow old and they forgot what you say, if you made a mistake. But today, no. You make one statement, you walk wrong, you smile wrong, you sneeze wrong, and suddenly it's blasted all over. There is no control. You cannot control information anymore. This is an important reality we need to address. And let me tell you, look at the YouTube, the FaceTime, the Instagram, and the Twitter, and everything else in between that was not bought by Google or Microsoft. What happens? They become a factor in the way you raise your children. Don't think this is not going to be a factor in the way you raise your children. You think your children will wait for you to come and teach them something? Oh God. No. That's old. That's beyond, that's caveman time. The moment something comes to the mind of a young adult, young child, he or she doesn't know, what's the first thing if they have access to it. And most likely, the possibility and the probability of them having access to it is extremely high. What is the first thing they do? What is that?
Ping.
Microsoft is paying you, man. Well, Yahoo is in the comeback right now, so I don't know. But anyways, Google. It became a verb. Google it. Imagine. Now, this has a lot of benefits, but also has so many negatives. Because your child now comes to you, Dad, this is what I know about this topic. And before you know it, you have like about 15 opinions. You don't even know what it is. How do you address this? Can you actually hold your child and hold him back or her back from exploring Google, from using the internet, from using Facebook? Okay, I know your dad is saying yes. Why are you saying no? He's like, no, you can't. See, young men and women today, as they're growing up, they expect that. Back in the days, when do you have a cell phone? Maybe if you're 21, 22, maybe if you're 18, God knows, if you can hold the cell phone in your hand, it was so heavy, so thick. Now, I think when they're given birth, the first thing after they put the diapers on, where's my iPhone? But it's seriously, it's something like I said, I'm not getting the iPhone 6. Why do I need it for? Still, you know, I have my iPhone 5. It's working. Honestly, I feel so old. Everyone's like has this, you know, slick iPhone 6 and they're using it. Like, when did you get the chance to even buy it? I'm so busy. I cannot stand. I don't have time to order it on the internet. Oh, Zaid, come on. iPhone 6, we all have it. And I actually watched. I did this on purpose. I tried to see how fast and how common will the iPhone 6 become. Before I wanted to study how I'm going to capture the data. Honest to God, this is what I did. When they released it, I wasn't paying attention that they released it. I was reading about it in the details, given that I'm into technology. And I was thinking, how would I get the study going? How would I capture the data? How would I measure the age groups? How would I do this and that? So I went out with the friends who were having coffee, and they all had it. And I just realized, wow, I was so late thinking about it. And it's not even 24 hours. So we deal with different lifestyles, with different elements. Did the Imams alayhim salam talk to us about the iPhones? As a matter of fact, they addressed the concepts of communication, how we talk. Whether there's an iPhone or there is a Samsung Galaxy, it does not matter at that point. There is you and there is your child. See, dear brothers and sisters, it is important to go back and realize that you and I live today in a life that has so much wealth of information and the access to it. So much is happening on TV today. Can you control how your child is receiving that information? Can you? You may control him or her to a certain age, but then they go to school. Then they drive in the car with you. What happens? They are going to look right or left, and they're going to see signs, billboards, they're going to see people. Technology is distributed so fast, and information becomes so quick into the user's hand. Now, how do you and I deal with it? Have we, as a community, and I'm not talking about we need a center or a mosque or an institution. We don't need. My question is, have we thought of how do we, as individuals who have faith in the way of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. How do we deal with this? And should we? At the end of the day, before we are Shia, before we are Muslims, before any of that, we're human beings. We deal with this like any other faith deals with it. Do you think the Christians like it? Or the Jews like it? Or the Buddhist or whatever other religion out there? They have the same problems we do. Hold on. So this means what? We cannot say it is only the problem of the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Problem number one. A lot of times that we make our issues so specific and special to us that we don't realize others are going through these issues also. And we can benefit from sharing with them and talking to them and exchanging ideas. Now, they have different restrictions than we do. They have different mindsets than we do. In America, by the way, Americans are religious. American people are religious people. Don't worry about the New York people, these dense cities that might have these crazy styles and crazy things they do. No, in general, American people are religious. They will listen to a religious message. Look at the non-profit spending, it's in the billions of dollars in the USA. In the USA, people give billions and billions of contributions and charity to different centers, different churches, different centers of worship, and they support good acts. They also, if you look on Sunday, turn the different channels, you'll see that there are listeners in the millions, and people make money, and people spend money. So we as a group, as a community, cannot isolate ourselves, but we need to understand how do we deal with others. It is important as individuals, as followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Look at Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. In the worst of times, you will never see them isolating themselves. And we are their followers. Whether Imam Ali alayhi salam, Imam Ali alayhi salam, is there someone who went through more than he did? Yet, he did not isolate himself from all the people around him. He stayed, although they took away what is rightfully his, but he was there preserving. They were messing up with the religion, but he knew he has choices. Either completely let go and isolate himself, or no, stay and remind and talk and fix as much as you can. Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, at the time with the fight with Muawiyah la'antullahi alayhi, look at this height of the tension. Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam had to make a decisive decision in the battlefield. If he goes and he fights, what will happen? Muawiyah then will be able to control everything, including the wisdom. And that's why Imam Hassan alayhi salam stopped the battlefield at that point. But on the contrary, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, what did he do? He went through until the moment of martyrdom. Why? For each one of them, they had a different time and place, different elements that decided the decision of the act at that point. Exactly like our supreme jurists are doing today. The beauty of our religion and our faith at the time of occultation of the 12th Holy Imam is where? We do not have one point that once it's attacked, everything dissolves. No, we have many points of strength. We have strong seminaries, strong jurists, wise jurists. Look at what happened just in the past few months. His Eminence Grand Ayatollah Al-Udhma As-Sayyid Ali Sistani. In one statement, he shocked the region. He revived the region after the criminals that are in Iraq and Syria were doing what they're doing. In one statement he made. You know what's so significant about that statement? When he declared that more people have to go and fight that are trained with all the conditions in Iraq. All the scholars, not only in Najaf, but in Qom, in the Islamic seminary, united around him and said everyone ought to listen to him. See, this completely diffuses this myth that our scholars don't communicate, don't talk, don't... No, in one statement, everyone came together. You think they did not know that it's happening? They did not communicate that? We go back to this. In our communities, we look and learn from our imams, from our maraja. Our maraja are not disconnected. Our maraja is very much in communication with one another. Our imams and our maraja, they looked at the time and place and they decided on the action. We see different actions by different imams. We see one of them who rose and he fought until martyrdom. The other, what happened? He maintained so he can preserve the wisdom. And he was killed. Another, he was in jail most of the time, but he built through communicating with all his followers through jail. A third, he built it through supplications, the word. A fourth, through knowledge. A fifth, a sixth, a seventh. Each one had a different style. What does this teach us? Lesson one. When someone listened to me carefully, because honestly, I am sick and tired of listening to the ignorant ones trying to take down our leadership. Listen carefully. If you establish someone as a person with knowledge and authority, wisdom, respect his or her work even if you don't agree with it. You don't know what angle he or she is looking at that you're missing. You don't know what is happening in Qatif, in Hassa, in Kuwait, in Bahrain. You don't know the details in Iraq, the details in Iran. You don't know the details in Syria. You don't know the details in Lebanon. You don't know who died and made you boss to make decisions on people. Oh, they're wrong. Oh, they don't know what they're... Oh, this is bad. Oh, why? How do you know? Do you see our scholars talking like this? No, they respect one another. So that's lesson one. Understand, see, but here's a problem. Where is the problem? We need to identify who holds the knowledge first. And when in doubt, just leave it alone. Move. You don't have to praise someone or ask someone else. It was in very few times through the history of our scholars that our scholars took a stand and they said, this person, don't follow him. Or this person, don't listen to him. Why? It's this freedom of thought that strengthened the community. Don't you have brains? Don't you have resources? Go and research. As long as you learn the right method to research. We'll get back to this topic. But now, let's look at us today. Let's look at our community. Allah Azza wa Jal says, I created you weak, made you strong, took the strength out, and returned you back weak. SubhanAllah, a cycle. You see it amongst us. Some of us are so energetic, have so much energy and the health, and some of us are weak. And the cycle goes on. We need each other. We need one another. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَمَنْ نُعَمِّرُهُ نُنَكِّسْهُ فِي الْخَلْقِ. And whoever we grant him long life, we reverse in creation. At the end of the day, no matter how strong you are, you will end up weak. So how do we deal with these different age groups? How do we deal with them? Because the strength and the energy is in the young. The wisdom is with the elderly. How do we live together when we have different opinions? See, stagnation, a community does not move forward when the energy is not being utilized. How do we utilize the energy of our young people? Where are they? What are they doing? How are we reaching out to everyone around us? One of the brothers asked me yesterday, he's like, I heard the community is larger. Where is it? Where is the youth? Where is the young men and women? Why aren't they here today? You know what? It really doesn't matter if they come here or not. What matters to me is this. Are you connected to them? Can you reach out to them? Have they left you alone or have you left them alone? These are, by the way, your responsibility, my responsibility. We're not free of this responsibility. The young people, the elderly. Look, are you missing someone who used to be here last month, 2 months ago, last year? Listen to me carefully. Have you seen an elderly last year that this year you don't see him anymore? Or last month that you don't see him today? What will you do? Probably most of us will go back home and never even worry about it. Yet, if you're in the community raised by Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, the adults should go and ask, where is Hajj Fulan? This man, where is he? What happened to him? Ask his family members, ask his relatives, check on him. Believe it or not, the moment you check on an elderly, you revived him or her. Someone cares for them. And sometimes they might talk and give you a headache, but sometimes they can give you a lot of wisdom. Exactly like sometimes when you, with all your energy, give them a headache, but also sometimes you're very useful. It goes both ways. If you huff and puff, oh my God, they want us to do this again. Where they come from, man? Why don't they see? Versus, let me listen attentively and benefit from their experience. Dear brothers and sisters, there is a group in the middle, the adults. There are the young, there's the elderly, and there's the adults. Now, I want to talk about all of them. If we don't address, because all of us are in all of these. See, we are born, we're given birth, and we have a body, and there is a soul. And when the Imam alayhi salam was asked, he said, "Ar-ruhu fil jasadi kal-ma'na fil lafzi." I need you to understand this so we can build on it. The soul in the body is like the meaning in the word. What does that mean? When I say, for example, house. House is a word I just said, I just uttered, okay? It carries a meaning. Can you touch the meaning? The meaning carries the pronounced word. Without a meaning, that word is meaningless. It carries no value. When I say the house, I'm referring to something real that exists. The soul itself, that spirit of yours, in your body, is the meaning and the value your body carries. If from your birth until you die, you're adding value to that spirit of yours. That is the spirit that will be moving and transitioning to the next life. And that is what you will be judged. That's what is called the I. How much are you fulfilling the I? How much are you feeding the I? How much are you teaching the eye? So, at a young age, let's talk about the young for a little bit. At a young age, there's a lot of energy. There's a lot of want to do. Do they know all the answers? Do the young people know all the answers? No. But are they pardoned because they don't know all the answers? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. Al-Imam Ali alayhi salam says it, جَهْلُ الشَّبَابِ مَعْذُورِ وَعِلْمُهُ مَحْصُورٌ. The ignorance of a young is excused, for his knowledge is very limited. Now let me ask you, who gives this knowledge to the youth? Who gives this knowledge to the young? And in the coming nights, I'm going to give details on the certain ages, how Ahlul Bayt teach us how to teach our youth add different age groups. But who teaches the age groups, this young group? See, dear brothers and sisters, I need to make this extremely clear. Young people are impressionable. They see someone and that one person makes them feel good in any way, shape, or form. They want to emulate. They want to do the things he or she is doing. Right or wrong? If I take the young man and woman, the young girl or boy that I have, and I put in front of him someone that will impress him or impress her, I became, as an individual, part of the makeup of the soul of my son or daughter, because I provided to him a form of a role model. So, if I am, for example, let's say, I don't know how many of you like to do shisha. You know what shisha is? Everyone froze like, I have no idea. How many of you like to do it? Okay, very few honest ones. Let me tell you though, is it the best environment? Is it really a good environment? Do I need to promote this? Why am I talking about it? Because so many of our youth right now, today, and I'm talking about reality, I see them. If you really don't know, just take some time and visit the Facebook and Instagram. It is everywhere. Now, let me ask you. And some will say, don't talk about it. I don't want to teach my kids. Your kids will know of it. Let me prevent them. Let me teach them so I can immune them from things like this. First of all, it's not good for your health. First, secondly, etc. But there's an important thing about it. Now, it's your choice whether you make it or you use it or not. But the environment, you know, today's cafes, when guys go to the cafe, to the coffee shops, and they hang out at the coffee shops, what happens? There's an environment. And when the environments look so close to one another, it makes the ability or the liking of crossing environments and atmospheres very doable. Meaning what? Look at the environment when you go to some of these shisha places and you see the smoke and you see the lights and you see, but what is it missing though? Is it a club? No, it's missing the liquor. It's missing the maybe inappropriateness of dress or whatsoever. But what happens when we go into such environments as youth, as young people? I start accepting this smoke, these lights, the atmosphere itself. I let go and let down my guard. So next time, when I have someone with me who, when I go to work and they want to go to the bar after that, they push me, they tell me, encourage me, I get there, I try to say no, but what do I see? Very like environment. This is permissible, this is not permissible. But with some nudging, with some encouragement, I'm more likely to cross that line. Why? I did not immune myself enough to say, yeah, it may be permissible, but I'm not going to teach myself and allow myself this. Let me give you this example. Imagine yourself going up a mountain and the road is from here all the way to that glass. But right by the glass is a very deep valley. If I want to be safe and I'm driving a car, do I drive right by the cliff or do I drive right where it's safe? Where do I drive? Where is safe? Why do I have to go and take the risk in that spot and that place? When I go into different atmospheres, when I go into different environments, and I push myself towards the edge, the moment I hit a bump in the road, I may flip. When I go, what happens when I go to these places? What happens when I sit in these environments? I am getting myself, my soul, accepting all of this. Guys and girls today, the way they dress up, with all the tight clothes, men and women, you don't know nowadays. The men and the women, the tight jeans, the tight dresses and all that stuff, what happened? That's not permissible at all, that's haram. Okay? But the more I take my children to that environment, what happens? See, here's the thing. I can tell my child that is haram and this is halal. This is permissible and that's not. The problem is when I take my children to an environment supposedly Islamic and it has acts like this. Now I'm confused. What do I tell them? Why? Because I confuse them. I say that this Muslim is doing something not permissible. Okay, why? So we need to provide the atmosphere. We need to care for the atmosphere. We are responsible, you and I, towards our children. By the way, someone might say, Alhamdulillah, man, I don't have no children. I'm good. No. It doesn't work that way. You are in a community that has children. You have responsibility towards them. Just because their parents are not there and you catch them doing something wrong, what do? Oh, I didn't see them. I didn't see that. You just walk away? No. Ahlul Bayt don't tell you walk away. That's not what is expected of you. You need to find a way to connect with them because now you have a responsibility of Amr ibn Ma'ruf and Nahi al Munkar, enjoining good and forbidding evil. But how do you do it? You don't have to go and yell and scream at them. And you don't go have to join them and have fun with them either. You don't do that. No. What do? You need to find the best method, the best style to educate them. Dear brothers and sisters, it's absolutely important that we learn. We are all responsible. One of the most important things that I want you to leave these 10 days and 10 nights, learning one thing. This community, look around you. You're responsible for them and their families and everyone else in here. It's your responsibility. He says, she says, they're followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Your hearts open up and you say, they're my responsibility now. They're your responsibility. What brings us together is the word Ya Hussein. Dear brothers and sisters, this is a very important task. And we need to address it and we need to learn how to solve these issues. We all make mistakes. Let me make it clear. I'm not here preaching to you that because I am holier than thou and I don't make mistakes. No, I'm the first to admit I make tons of mistakes. But I'm willing to learn. I'm willing to listen. رحم الله من أهدى إلي عيوبي. May Allah have mercy on those who tell me where my faults are. But how do we talk to one another? How do we open the dialogue so we all can grow and we all can reach our destined purpose? We will learn in these coming nights what Ahlul Bayt teach us. How to solve these social issues that we have. You know, have you ever thought or created a study, did a study on the Idara community? How healthy is this community? And how do you measure health? Their heartbeats? Whether they can, the physical health? No. The social issues that we have. And I consider myself part of this community. What social issues we have? How our young, our adults, and our elderly are thinking. Are we thinking on the same level? Are we thinking for the same things? Are we trying to accomplish the same things? What I have found in many different communities, dear brothers and sisters, there are three different ways of thinking. And this is one of the biggest failures that we have. I hope it's not here, but I will address these issues. What I want you to do is help me. Help me understand. Help me help you understand. And first and foremost, be true to yourself. I have a responsibility here. to extend this minbar to each and every house. The minbar is not at the idara. You know when idara becomes successful? You know, I want the board members of idara, if they're sitting here. Let me ask you, I have a question. Who are the board member, any board member of the idara sitting in the crowd? Okay, see, that's a problem. Man, they're never inviting me again here. But why? How do they measure? Who knows what I'm talking about? Come, listen, see the interaction. I'm sure they have a lot of things to do. I'm going to hear of it, inshallah. But we need to realize that when is the Idara Ja'fariya successful? It's not when I have the member at Idara and you come to Idara. We, the Idara Ja'fariya, I'm going to take responsibility, become successful when the member is in each and every one of your houses. When we have reached to each and everyone, and let me tell you, I am not going to blame the resident scholar for not doing, he not reaching out. He is one person. MashaAllah, you're so many. How can we expect one person to do so much? And he's doing so great of a job. But what I will blame is all of us if we fail. Because if we fail, we all fail. Period. And you know who we failed? You know who you hurt? The Imam of the time, Sahib al-Asr wa Zaman alayhi salam. We have narratives that say al-Imam salamullahi ta'ala alayhi is hurt when he sees an individual doing something wrong. What about when he sees a community failing? And we call for his appearance? Why do we have two faces with him? Why do we have two faces with him? Dear brothers and sisters, Al-Imam Al-Husayn Salamullahi Ta'ala Alayhi, he gave his life for what reason? So we can be revived, you and I. So this community can be built today. So we don't fail. Any moment we have struggle and hardships, what do? We remember what the Imam gave in the way of the purpose. Are you doing as much as the Imam? Are you putting everything you have for that purpose, or are you just thinking and worried about your livelihood? Al-Imam al-Husayn salamullahi ta'ala alayhi, dear brothers and sisters, as he went from Mecca to Karbala, he stood right in the way, on the way, in a land. He said, what is the name of this land? They said, Nainawa. He said, does it have another name? They said, Shati. He said, is there another name for this land? They said, the name of this land is Karbala. He said, by Allah, this is Karbun Wabala. Huna turammalun niswan. Here the woman will be widowed. Huna tudbahul atfal. Fall here, the children will be massacred. Huna tuhtakul harim. Inzilu bina ya kiram. Oh, honorable ones, come down. Let us settle here. Huna mahallu quburina. This is the site of our graves. Huna mahsharuna. This is where we all will be resurrected. This is what my grandfather Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam promised me. Here Lady Zainab heard her brother Imam Hussein. She said, brother, you sound like a one who saw with certainty his place of martyrdom. Today
when I heard you, today when I saw you, today it's like the day of martyrdom of my mother Fatima. اليوم ماتت أمي فاطمة and my father Ali and my brother Al-Hassan. Ah, the poet describes Lady Zainab, dear brothers and sisters, in the land of Karbala. Let us go to the day of Muharram and look at Lady Zainab, what happened to her. Let us see how the poet describes Lady Zainab. Ah, at the moment when everyone was gone, when Imam Hussein was killed and massacred in the land of Karbala, the women are running away, the children are running into the desert. Ah, تدعو أباها أمير المؤمنين ألايا. She calls her father, يا أبا يا علي يا والدي. حكمت فينا رعايانا. Look at what they have done to us. Oh, Father Ali, I don't have anyone with me. I don't have Ali al-Akbar. I don't have Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Oh, Father Ali, where's Hussein? Habibi Hussein. Ah, ya Zainab, ya Zainab. Ah, ya Zainab, ya Zainab. Beloved Lady Zainab, I imagine her in the land of Karbala on the 10th day of Muharram in the battlefield, the men, women and children in the desert, and Imam Hussein laying on the grounds of Karbala. What is she saying? What is she calling? Hussein, Hussein, brother Hussein. Everyone with me, call Zainab. Hussein, Hussein, brother Hussein. Why aren't you calling with me, everyone? Hussein. Brother Hussein, let us, dear brothers and sisters, call upon Imam Hussein and visit him from here. As-salamu ala al-Hussein wa ala Ali ibn al. Everyone together, as-salamu. As-salamu ala al-Hussein. Louder, as-salamu. As-salamu ala wa ala Ali ibn al-Hussein. One more time, as-salamu. As-salamu. For the sake of Allah, louder one more time. As-salamu ala al-Hussein wa ala Ali al-Hussein wa ala awlad al-Hussein wa ala. اللهم كن لوليك الحسن.
حجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. صلوات حسين
حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين
حسين
حسين
حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين
حسين
حسين حسين
حسين
Hussein Hussein
Hussein Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein
Hussein Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Everyone,
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Buried in your heart, the son of Fatima. Buried in your heart, the son of Fatima. Warith of Adam, wa Nuh Mustafa. Warith of Adam, wa Nuh Mustafa. Then Hussein ibn Ali al-Murtada. Then Hussein ibn Ali al-Murtada. Who defied every zulm and ashkiya. With his final call you still reverberate. With his final call you still reverberate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
faith.
He who taught us how to brave adversity.
He who taught us how to brave adversity.
Never compromise on your humanity.
Never compromise on your humanity.
He who fought malice with generosity.
He who fought malice with generosity.
And became the standard of integrity. Only if his model we could emulate. Only if his model we could emulate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate.
Everyone,
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Karbala, your message is pristine and pure.
Karbala, your message is pristine and pure.
Never be unjust nor injustice endure.
Never be unjust nor injustice endure.
Wealth and power never should inspire all. Wealth and power never should inspire awe. Everything you heard and everything you saw, till our final breath we shall commemorate. Till our final breath we shall commemorate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate.
Everyone,
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Karbala, you would be lost in history. Karbala, you would be lost in history.
And Ali Akbar wa Abbas Jari.
And Ali Akbar wa Abbas Jari.
Were it not for your Sahib Ali.
Were it not for your Sahib Ali.
In the court of arrogance and tyranny, now forever will your sermon resonate. Now forever will your sermon resonate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate.
Everyone,
Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. Every Ashura we Shia must renew.
Every Ashura we Shia must renew.
Karbala's anthems in our character too.
Karbala's anthems in our character too.
Our mourning should inspire what we do.
Our mourning should inspire what we do.
Only then can we deliver what is due. Mawla, help our speech and actions integrate. Mawla, help our speech and actions integrate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Till the skies illuminate with the light you radiate. Karbala, your tragedy we will narrate. tragedy we will narrate. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein.